Blackstone Audio presents Arlo Finch in the Valley of Fire by John August. This book is read by James Patrick Cronin. Wisdom begins in wonder. Socrates. Probably. 1. Pine Mountain. It didn't look like a house at all. True, it had many of the things you expect to see in a house, shingles, windows, bricks, but they didn't seem to be arranged in a house-like way. Instead, the building slumped against the wooded hillside like a pile of debris left over from proper homes. To the left, a door hung 6 feet off the ground, no stairs beneath it. On the second floor, a blue plastic tarp stirred in the fall breeze, revealing the wooden skeleton of an abandoned room. The front door was hidden in the shadows of a sagging porch. From the back seat of his mother's car, Arlo Finch took silent note of all the dangers he saw. His sister, JC, just said it. It looks like a murder house. Their mother switched off the ignition and unfastened her seatbelt. Arlo knew she was counting to three. Mom counted to three a lot these days. We should be grateful it's a house. I'm not sure it is, said Arlo. They'd been driving for 6 hours, and 3 days before that, so at the very least it felt good to get out and stretch. The bright sun and cool breeze were refreshing, like jumping in a pool without getting wet. The smell in the air reminded Arlo of the year in Philadelphia when they got a real Christmas tree from the empty lot by the gas station. Here, high in the Colorado mountains, everywhere he looked were Christmas trees, only much, much bigger. They swayed against the pale blue sky. Their mother unlocked the U-Haul trailer behind the car. I need to pee, announced JC. Me too, said Arlo. Well, go inside, said their mother. Your uncle is expecting us. Arlo followed his sister to the creaking front porch, past a rusted metal fence and stacks of lichen-covered rocks. JC was 15 and sturdy, built like the women you see throwing shot put in the Olympics. Back in Philadelphia and Chicago, she'd spent most days in her room watching videos on her computer and dyeing her hair different colors, emerging only for meals with an exaggerated sigh. Arlo Finch had just turned 12, but he looked younger. He was small, with dark hair that never stayed put. His left eye was brown, but his right eye was emerald green. Heterochromia iridum was the medical term, which made it sound like a magic spell or a disease, but it wasn't either one. It's just how things are, his mother said. Like how some people have green eyes and others have brown. You have one of each. Some teachers assumed his mismatched eyes were the reason Arlo had a hard time reading, but doctors said his vision was just fine. It was Arlo's brain that sometimes had trouble with words. Still, he could read the sign by the front door. Solicitors will be shot and stuffed. JC knocked. The door slowly swung open. It hadn't been locked. Uncle Wade? She called softly. No answer. Hello? Said Arlo, not any louder. The house beyond the door was messy, but not murdery. Peering in from the porch, they could see stairs leading up to the second story, each step cluttered with books and boxes and bits of scrap metal. To the left, the living room had 3 sagging sofas and an upside-down rocking chair. To the right, a dining room table was filled with 15 stuffed animals. Not the cuddly type you give a child, but the kind that used to be actual living creatures, like you see on field trips to the Natural History Museum. Arlo spotted eagles and foxes and raccoons, all frozen, mid-action. On second thought, the house was a little murdery, but JC stepped right in. It's trespassing, warned Arlo in a whisper. Mom owns the house, she said, crossing the dining room and pushing through a swinging door. Arlo supposed that JC was technically right. According to their mother, the house had been specifically left to her when their grandparents died. But Uncle Wade lived here and always had. It was his sign by the door, and his dead animals on the table. It seemed like a bad time to argue the details of inheritance. Still, Arlo had to pee. He followed JC through the swinging door. The kitchen was dark and cluttered, with five open cereal boxes lined up on the counter.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.